Hey, Christian Post, it's Jeannie here, and today I am joined by someone who is behind one of the biggest animation, I would say, series and movies that the Christian world, children in the Christian world, have been learning from for decades. Phil Vischer, there's over 50 million VeggieTale movies in the homes of people from all over. And it's all because of this man, what the Lord has put in him. And he has been speaking out about race and racism in America. And here at the Christian Post, we just wanted to get inside of his heart, inside of his mind, learn more about why he's passionate about this. And yeah, Phil, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Glad I can be here.
Yeah, so we've been covering, I started with your blog that you wrote, I think it's Racial Injustice Has Benefited Me.
Yeah, that went over interestingly.
Let's talk about that. You know, I think that was, and I think I saw going back in YouTube, you have talked about race before. This isn't the first time.
Right.
Which I want to say thank you for that, because a lot of people are thinking that now everyone wants to be passionate about an issue because it's all over.
Because it's cool, yeah. Yeah. Someone immediately said, oh, Phil, why weren't you talking about this 2 weeks ago? Yeah. And so I pointed them to the podcast we did 3 years ago and said, I was oh, look at me, all the way back. So, and that started, my brother is the dean of a law school in Minneapolis, the Catholic University, St. Thomas University. He's the dean of the law school. And after the Philando Castile shooting, which I believe was near 2016 and led to quite a bit of protests, I-94 in Minneapolis during the protests was shut down. A group of protesters walked out onto the interstate and shut it down. And a lot of people in Minneapolis were very angry about that. It came out in the press that one of the leaders of that protest was an African-American woman who was a law professor who worked for my brother. Oh. And so angry alumni demanded that my brother fire her for participating in that protest. And he said he wasn't going to. And instead he went back to them and said, what I want you to do, you know, these were angry white alumni, I want you to try to think of what it would take, what would have to happen in your life that would make you so upset that you would walk out onto an interstate and shut it down. Hmm. What would it take for you to be that upset? And then my family started a Bible conference in Northwest Iowa way back in the 1930s, and it's still going on every year. And my brother and I were supposed to teach a whole week class, you know, in 95% white Northwest Iowa. And my brother decided to do a day on racial justice, on racial inequality. Mm. And so he did a whole mess of research, and then I did a day on new atheism, and I did a day on evolution. We were talking about kind of hot button issues in our culture. And, but the data that he had come up with about racial, you know, inequality in America just blew my mind, you know? And so I came back to Chicago where we do the Holy Post podcast. And I mentioned on the podcast, my brother taught this course and I just learned stuff. I had no idea. And people said, Oh, tell us. And I was like, So I got my brother's notes. I said, would you give me all your notes for that class? And I presented them on the podcast as a special episode. That became one of the most popular episodes we'd ever done, as lots of white Christians like me said, I'd never heard half of that stuff.
Yeah.
So that was 2017. Then we get to George Floyd in 2020, and Minneapolis again, protests again, shutting down interstates in Minneapolis again, and then spreading all over the country. And I'm starting to see pop up all over social media. You know, why are they so angry? Racism is done. Racism, we ended it in the 1960s. Yeah. So, you know, why are people so angry? And I started pointing people to that podcast episode to say, this might help. It's an hour and 15 minutes long and you have to go 20 minutes in before it starts. And so people just weren't doing it. And I'm seeing all these little videos fly back and forth. Like, you know, here's someone saying there's no such thing as racism. Here's someone, you know, here's two people arguing about white privilege. Here's, you know, and a lot of these videos just didn't have any data in them. They were opinions, but not history. And so I thought, okay, well, what if I took that that podcast episode, that hour and 50-minute podcast episode, and tried to cram it down into as short a possible video as I could, which turned out to be a 17-minute video, to walk through 100 years of racial history in America. And it turns out that just went absolutely viral.
It did.
Yeah, as of yesterday, it's been watched 5 million times.
Wow. Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Because you penned the blog before the video, correct?
I did, yes.
So how did the data turn from historical data to something that you're like, I want to examine my own life and how this has benefited me?
The other part of the story is my family has attended, we moved from Iowa to the suburbs of Chicago in 1980. I had a month left of middle school. And then we started going to a church. It's in our denomination, our local denominational church. So I was in middle school. We went, so my mother's been at that church without break for almost 40 years now.
Wow.
The church went through some really rough times. It was an aging white congregation, and it was shrinking, just steadily shrinking. And then we had no pastor, and then it was getting smaller and smaller. And it looked like, you know, we were kind of on death watch for our denomination. And our district superintendent in our denomination said, hey, I think you should talk. There's another church in the denomination right down the street that's growing, that has a really dynamic young pastor. They don't have a building. You have a building, no pastor, and you're shrinking. Maybe you guys should talk about merging. And we said, oh, okay, what church is it? And it was a second generation immigrant Korean congregation. You know, well, wait, what? So you want to take an all white, mostly white congregation and an Asian immigrant congregation and just shove them together and hope that that works. And so we spent about a year meeting and discussing it. And it's been 4 years ago now. I was an elder at the time. Both congregations voted, and we decided to merge and create a multi-ethnic congregation. Mm-hmm. So we have a Korean senior pastor, a Korean youth pastor, a Korean college pastor, a Filipino worship pastor, and then most of the rest of the staff is white from the old white church. And so we put all that together. But the amazing thing is, since we did that 4 years ago, the church has doubled in size. It's now about 1,000 people a week meeting, and it's African American, and it's Latino, and we have Indians, and we're getting like 120 college kids on a typical weekend, because they want to worship someplace that looks like the world they're actually living in, that they're growing up in. And because of this, all of a sudden, I'm sitting around the fire in my small group with an African-American couple, listening to their stories of what it's like to live in white America, you know, in the white suburbs. And I'm talking with an Asian family about what it's like to be Asian in white America. And I'm hearing stories I've just never, that are completely beyond my experience. And that's what led me to start to look at my own story and the way I tell my own story. And that was the theme of that blog. Because if you know my story, you know, my dad walked out when I was 9 years old, my parents split up, and we kind of went from upper middle class to probably for a couple of years, you know, we were living below the poverty line because my mother had never worked before. She had a nurse's degree, but had never practiced. So she had to pull out the dusty nursing degree and try to find a job in Muscatine, Iowa, to support three kids after my dad had left. And then we relocated to Chicago, to the Chicago suburbs, and we went to school, and we, you know, my brother went to Harvard, and he became a successful, you know, a college professor, and my sister has a doctorate, and my mom got her doctorate, and she became a college professor. So it's this, I used to tell the story like we had nothing, but we worked really hard, and then now look at us, you know, what a success story. And then the more I'm learning about, in particular, wealth inequality between African-American families and white families. The average white family has 10 times the household wealth of the average black family. You know, 10 times. The average black family has 60% of the income of the average white family, but only 10% of the wealth. And the reason that is because most wealth, most intergenerational wealth in America is home ownership. That's how most Americans have generated wealth to pass from one generation to the next. And we very, very actively, starting in the 1930s, encouraged white families to own homes and discouraged non-white families from owning homes. You know, and there were policies that we put in place, and there were specific reasons which made sense at the time. They now they look horribly racist in hindsight. You know, we declared that white and black families were incompatible racial groups and should never live in the same community. You know, that was in 1932 in the Federal Housing Administration guidebook. So there are all these things that I never heard before. So I would grow up wondering, you know, why is my suburb almost all white? And yet I can drive. You know, I live in the Chicago area. I can drive 10 miles that way, and there's another one that's almost all black. Why is that? How did that happen? Well, guess what? It wasn't an accident. It was policy. And because of that, so few African-American families have homes that they've owned that have been passed through generations that have generated wealth for college, in particular wealth for how do you move and start your life over if your life falls apart.
Yeah.
And I realized that when our lives fell apart in Muscatine, Iowa, and we had nothing, we didn't have nothing. We had a nice house for Muscatine, Iowa standards. And my mom was able to sell that house and use the money to buy a much smaller house, but in a nice suburb of Chicago, which had, guess what, funded by all those nice houses, fantastic schools.
I had no idea that these things were put in place on purpose. So it wasn't until I read your blog that I started to think, wow, yeah, the my reach to opportunity was so much further because of the area that I grew up in. So people can fight that all they want, but I know it was my reality. What I have been seeing a lot of is people debunking the systematic racism that existed and things like that. Can you talk a little bit about that? I don't know if you've seen any even responses to what you've
yeah,
released.
I think it makes sense to argue. There's a pretty good argument to say there aren't. It is very hard to find explicitly racist laws today because it's illegal. You know, so even if they pop up somewhere, pretty soon somebody's going to notice and file a lawsuit, and they're knocked down. But that doesn't mean that there isn't residual racism from prior laws. So just for example, do you know why, if you're an agricultural worker, you can't get unemployment insurance? There's no unemployment insurance for agricultural workers. Do you know why that is?
Mm-hmm.
Because in the 1930s, during the Depression, when unemployment insurance was proposed, Southern senators insisted that it be for white people only. That no black people could get unemployment insurance. And Northern senators said, no, we're not doing that. But they had to come up with a compromise. The compromise was, okay, it doesn't apply to agricultural workers or service workers, which in the South were the jobs held by black people.
Yeah.
So it was the same thing. It was the same result. It's not an explicitly racist law, but it was done in a way that had the same impact. And we see that over and over again. There were, whites only zoning ordinances in suburbs, you know, where if you were a non-white family, it was against the realtor's code of ethics to show a house in a white neighborhood to a non-white family. You would lose your realtor's license until 1950 if you helped a black family buy a house in a white neighborhood. So that the realtor's code of ethics is a system. That's a system. So that's not an individual sin. That's a systemic sin. And we forget that the Bible has both. Okay. The Bible, we always talk about, you know, we're called to repent as individuals of our individual sins. But Israel over and over again is called to repent as a nation for things that not every member of the nation did. You know, after the exile, they come back and they start intermarrying with people from other nations. That's against God's law. They're called to repent. Did every single Israelite intermarry with another nation, with a woman from? Of course not. But the whole nation is called to repentance. So, so we're so individualistic in America that we can't stand the notion of being held responsible for anything that we didn't individually do.
Yeah.
And so we focus on the New Testament, which is a much more individualistic focus because it's not about a nation. It's about individuals, you know, within the Roman Empire. If you go back to the Old Testament, you see the people of God time and time again called to repent for things they did collectively as a nation, not individually. And I think that's a moment we're at in the church as the people of God to say, okay, no, you personally never owned slaves. You personally never kicked African Americans out of your coffee shop. You know, you personally did not redline your neighborhood so that African Americans couldn't get subsidized mortgages. But we collectively, you know, we're so quick to say, we won World War II. We won the Cold War. We sent a man to the moon. No, you didn't do any of those things. But America did those things. And we love to put ourselves together when it's something good. Then you say, we oppressed the Native Americans. I didn't do that. Don't say, so we clearly have a double standard where we love to associate ourselves with the great things America has done and hate to be associated with the terrible things America has done. America is no better or worse than we are. And we all do good and terrible things. So some of the pushback for me has been, you're making America sound terrible, and that really makes me sad. It's like, no, America is no nobler nor sinful than we are. It is the sum of us. So unless you reject the idea that you are sinful, you can't reject the idea that America is sinful. And we need to repent of those sins.
I'm so glad that you brought the Bible into it and gave us a breakdown. You know, I've done other interviews with people on race and just seeking education, you know, about it, and even just some pointers, some spiritual pointers, some natural pointers. And many of our conservative readers are pushing back. You know, they say the gospel is all that we need. They think that the things that you probably just said is too liberal. Can you talk a little to that?
Yeah. It's funny, you know, and this is a little controversial to say, but it's true. We never say the gospel is all we need when we talk about abortion. We say we need conservative Supreme Court justices, and we need to change laws, and we need new guidelines, and we need new policies. Somehow, when we turn the page to racism, now the gospel is all we need. And we don't need any laws. We don't need to do anything to change. Nothing needs to change in society except the heart. So I find it a little funny when we're picking the issues that we personally care about and saying, we really need to be active. We need to go out. We need to go out and protest abortion. And we do. You know, I'm with you. Let's go out and protest abortion. Yeah. But then to say, oh, wait, the thing you want to protest. No, the gospel is all we need. Like, what? Let's take a step back and examine that. I think we might have a double standard there. So I think God cares about both. I think he cares about the unborn. I think he cares about the newborn black boy in the inner city who has a 1 in 4 chance of ending up in prison in his lifetime, is more likely to go to prison than to go to college. I think that breaks God's heart also. You know, and I've had people push back and say, well, rank them. Rank abortion versus racism. I don't think God has a big wall chart of sin saying, where does this one rank? So we can walk and chew gum at the same time. We can be pro-life and pro our black friends at the same time. We can be anti-racist and anti-abortion at the same time. Our politics make it difficult. Because
I was going to say, yeah, I mean, we're in a election year, you know, so many people think that this is all because there's this big scheme, you know, political scheme.
We've taken all of these issues and we've divided them between two buckets, the liberal bucket and the conservative bucket. And if you identify yourself as a conservative, you can't care about anything that the liberals care about. And if you identify yourself as a liberal, you can't care about anything that the conservatives, that's ridiculous. And as Christians, here's what that means. You want to know what that means? I'll tell you what that means. It means we've made our political identity more important than our spiritual identity. Okay, because Jesus is never going to say, I would care about that issue, except I hear liberals care about that issue. Or I would care about that issue, except I hear Republicans care about that issue. So I'm not going to care about that issue. No, Jesus' heart went out to the least of these. You know, and the least of these is the unborn. The least of these is African Americans in the inner city who don't have a chance to get a good job, who can't find fresh food within a 5-mile radius, who will be discriminated against in housing practices. I mean, we've seen recently when a African American woman applies for an apartment in New York City, she's more likely to get the apartment if she has an Asian roommate and the Asian roommate puts her name on the application instead of the African American name. Okay, there's no law that says African American women can't rent apartments, but you're more likely to get a note back saying the apartment's no longer available if your name sounds African American. So we can be upset about that without it meaning we're somehow betraying our tribe, because mm-hmm. our tribe is Christ followers. It's not Democrats, it's not Republicans, it's Christ followers, and he cares about everybody.
Spiritually, what can people do? You know, there's these biases that are ingrained in a lot of people, right? You know, with my skin color, I too had to come to terms with, it doesn't matter that I even grew up in a neighborhood that was probably redlined or whatever. I still have more privileges than a lot of my Black brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. How can we encourage people to stop being offended with what's happening right now and actually deal with maybe there are some things that I should look at?
Yeah, I mean, I go back to what my brother said to his angry alumni when they said, you need to fire that woman because she shut down I-94. And he said, I want you to tell me what would make you so upset that you would do what she just did. Just think about that. You know, so for every white Christian out there, whether you consider yourself liberal, conservative, libertarian, moderate, independent, I don't even care. What could happen that would make you so upset that you would go out and protest like that, that you might even feel like picking up a rock and throwing it through a window? You know, and if you say, I would never ever do that because that's not American. Well, you kind of have to remember that's how America started. You know, America started as a protest. It started with people in the middle of the night picking up boxes of tea and throwing them violently off a ship in protest. We started, and then, okay, are you a Protestant? Are you a Protestant? What does that word mean? What's the root of Protestant? It's protest. We all started out as protesters. That's our whole, you're American, you're a protester. You're a Protestant, you're a protester. So we're all protesters. What we don't like is when people protest against things that we're not that upset about. Then we get kind of bent out of shape. You know, and we really don't like property damage. You know, and that's understandable. Don't, you know, hey, that was my Arby's. That was my favorite Arby's. You just burnt out my favorite Arby's. Yeah. Okay, if that's the worst thing that's ever happened to you in your life, that you lost your favorite Arby's, you're doing pretty well. Because there are people all over the world that are being persecuted in ways that are real and violent and bloody and way worse than losing your favorite Arby's. So it's okay. They had insurance. They can build a new Arby's. Stop staring at what's happened and look at the issues behind. Ask the question, you know, what would make you so upset that you would be willing to do that? And we did a whole podcast episode about the Christian tendency to enjoy conspiracy theories. You know, and just the people like with the coronavirus, you know, is Bill Gates. Bill Gates did it, and because he wants to microchip the world. You know, it's like, oh, okay, let's look at the stories that people are linking to that would lead them that conclusion, and then see where maybe we're running too far. You know, and it goes all the way back to, you know, the Q controversies and Pizzagate, and, you know, and Democrats have children in slavery in the basement under a pizza parlor in Washington, D.C., and all these crazy stories that lead people to do crazy things. And conservative Christians have a high proclivity to buy into some of those stories, partly because we believe the world is actually against us, you know, which is kind of biblical. There is some biblical basis in that. Partly because of the history of the 20th century, and starting with the Scopes Monkey Trial and the history of fundamentalist Christianity, we felt that the American media and the American intelligentsia, the elites, quote unquote, turned on us. You know, right about 1920 to 1930, we believe that America turned on us and we pulled back, we became more insular, and we became more angry and more suspicious. And that's gone on ever since. So when we hear, you know, I heard that Bill Gates is trying to take over the world and put microchips in all of our children, and that's probably the mark of the beast, you know, it's like, that makes sense. That makes sense to me. So now it's the same thing when we see a riot, when we see a race riot, and we hear, oh, I heard that George Soros funded that riot. Oh, that makes sense. That makes sense that a rich guy who's on the other side politically is behind all this. We just have to calm the heck down, because the other side will do it to us too. You know, I don't know if you've ever watched any episodes of The Handmaid's Tale on Hulu. Okay, there are people on the far left that believe that is what I want, because I'm a conservative Christian, that I want America to look like The Handmaid's Tale. So The Handmaid's Tale is kind of a, you know, a conspiracy theory about conservative Christians.
That Christianity was radicalized.
Oh, yes, that's what we would do. That's what we would do. We would, you know, enslave women and make them have babies for us and, you know, make them cover them, their... And you can find somewhere online a sermon from some preacher somewhere that will support that suspicion. Oof. Okay. So they do it to us. We do it to them. We find some voice, radical voice on the left, and say, aha, they want to ban the Bible. You know, they want to get rid of all white depictions of Jesus. That's this week's news.
How do we keep the heart of Jesus in this, when there are these extremes?
I don't think Jesus ever looked at a stranger and assumed the worst about them, ever. I think he always assumed the best. You know, the story of the Good Samaritan, you know, it literally is a story of your enemy, the person you despise, being the one who helps you, being the one who loves you. You know, so when he's telling a story like that, he's just not letting you have prejudice against your enemy. He's not letting you think the worst, assume the worst. Mm-hmm. And when we assume the worst, we're going against the teaching of Christ. You know, so when I look at my enemy and I see him as my brother, and say, how can I show this person love? You know, but I think he's trying to ruin America. That is not my number one priority as a follower of Jesus, to worry about who is or isn't more likely to ruin America. My number one priority as a follower of Jesus is to show him the love of Jesus. That's it. And then we'll take it from there and we'll probably become friends. Some of my best friends now are atheists. One of them is a very prominent atheist, because I reviewed his book on the podcast and I kind of took it apart because I thought he was wrong. And one of his followers said, hey, well, why don't you have him on and debate him? I was like, well, I don't want to debate him, but I'll invite him to be on the podcast. So he agreed. He came on the podcast. We start talking and we became friends. And I've stayed at his house. And he considers me a friend now, because I'd never approached him as, you are an enemy that I'm going to defeat.
Let's talk VeggieTales.
VeggieTales
is back. That's so exciting. Have you been afraid at all that people are going to take this out on VeggieTales? What's to come with VeggieTales? Let's talk a little bit about VeggieTales. And I know I've kept you long enough.
VeggieTales is now owned by NBC Universal, which is a big, you know, giant media company. And they did a deal with the Trinity Broadcast Network to create some new episodes, which I've been involved in. I need to do what I believe God has called me to do. You know, regardless of whether, yeah, I actually had someone say, you know, a couple of weeks ago, you know, man, I really love VeggieTales, but I'm so sorry that you're a leftist now. Like, well, if loving my neighbor means you can't like VeggieTales anymore, first of all, I'm not sure you watched episode number three, which was, are you my neighbor? That was episode number three. Are you my neighbor? And it was about loving the weirdos and the people that are different. So, you know, it's okay. I'll keep making veggies as long as they invite me to, and I'll keep, you know, talking about interesting things, because we are in such a crucial moment where our culture is becoming increasingly post-Christian. And that makes us very uncomfortable because it is very new. We are not used to being, you know, a minority.
Yeah.
And we don't know what to do with that. And that's, it's very easy to just default to anger, because that's the human response, you know, to a loss of privilege or a loss of power or a loss of influence, is to fight back. This is a perfect opportunity to go back to the way the church was in the first, second, third century and say, well, gee, they had zero influence. They had zero political power. What did they do? They loved people. They loved people, and it changed the Roman Empire. It absolutely transformed the Roman Empire. So we need to think of ourselves a little more like that, that we're not living in the promised land. We're living in the Roman Empire, where we are exiles, and we influence by love, not by anger.
Yes, what an opportunity we have to really show the love of Christ to a world that so desperately needs it. Phil, I thank you so much for joining us, for sharing from your perspective. I know our readers have been wondering, and I am just so grateful that not only do you have the historical information that you presented to us, but you are also using your voice as a white man, a successful white man in this country, influential, to share that with others. Thank you. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
I don't think so. It's a Holy Post podcast. You can check it out. We talk about stuff like this every week. It gets pretty interesting. And we'll keep doing what we're doing. You keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you so much.